For a continuous function, Riemann integration works by partitioning the domain of the function and approximating the area under the curve by rectangles. We can place the rectangles such that they approximate the area from above or from below. As we make the rectangles thinner, both upper and lower approximation approach the same value, which is the area under the curve. This approach also works if we have a function with a single discontinuity. The lower approximation is here always the same. When we look at the upper approximation, it first looks like the area would be different, but as you make the rectangles thinner, both approximations approach the same value, so the function can be integrated with Riemann integration. Let's look at a series of functions. Each function is only discontinuous on finitely many rational numbers whose denominator is sufficiently small. As there are only finitely many discontinuities, these functions are Riemann integrable by the same reasoning as before. But as we let n tend to infinity, we get a function which is 1 for all the rationals and 0 for all the irrationals. If we try to integrate this function by approximating it from above and from below, we see that the upper approximation is 1 while the lower approximation is always 0. This is the Dirichlet function, and it's not Riemann integrable. To handle this fault of the Riemann integral, we may take a different approach at integration. Instead of partitioning the domain of the function, we partition the range. Then we fit a simple function under the curve. The area under the curve of this function can easily be computed. By partitioning the range in smaller parts, the approximation of the area becomes better and approaches the actual area under the curve. This is the Lebesgue integral. This approach leads us to the same answer as before, but the method used is much stronger, as we will see. For instance, we may think about other domains than just the real numbers. As we don't have to partition the domain anymore, the domain can be any set on which we can talk about size. Measure theory describes how we can describe the domain by generalizing concepts such as length, area, and volume. To get a sense of how we might generalize the concept of size, we are first going to look at how area behaves in ordinary two-dimensional space. But how can we define area? And to which sets can we assign an area to? The most basic shape we can assign an area to is a rectangle. The area of the rectangle is just the product of the length of the sides. This assigns an area to all rectangles of all sizes. The area stays the same if you look at the rectangle without its sides or just with some of the sides. Once we got two sets to which we can assign an area, we can construct the union. This set should also have some area. If they don't overlap, the area of the union is equal to the sum of the area of the two sets. Another thing we can do is to take the difference of one set to another. Then the area of the difference is equal to the area of the first set minus the area of the second set, if the second set lays inside the first set. The third elementary set operation we can perform to get another set, which we want to assign an area to, is to take the intersection of two sets. So far, all the methods to get more sets to which we assign an area are pretty simple. As you just start from rectangles, you can just get sets which are in some way a combination of rectangles. But we also know that more complex shapes like triangles have an area. To get this area, we approximate the area with rectangles. As we add more rectangles, the approximation gets better, and in the limit, we get the entire triangle. What we have done here is to take the countable union of sets. The area of the union is then the sum of all the parts, if none of the parts intersect. Let's look at which sets we were able to assign an area to. These sets will be called measurable. First of all, the empty set is measurable as its area is just zero. Also, every rectangle is measurable. If we know some measurable sets, we can construct more measurable sets by taking the union, the set difference, or the intersection of two sets. We also get a measurable set by taking the countable union of measurable sets. If we want to generalize this, we first should try to reduce these assumptions to as few as possible. First of all, we notice that the union of two sets is the same as the countable union if we let all the sets of index higher than 2 be the empty set. So we don't need this assumption. Next, we can replace the difference with another operation called the complement, which is just the difference of the whole space with a set. Using this set identity between the difference and the complement, we see that we just have to assume that the complement is measurable. Next, we look at the intersection. Using this set identity, we see that the intersection just reduces to the union and the complement. Let's rephrase these observations in a more abstract definition, the sigma algebra. A sigma algebra is a collection of subsets that contains the empty set and is closed under complementation and under countable unions. Using this definition, we can say that so far we identified the measurable sets as the smallest sigma algebra containing all rectangles. Now let's look at the properties of the function which assigns the area, which we call a measure. Firstly, it's a function from the collection of measurable sets to the non-negative real numbers, where we include positive infinity. The measure of a rectangle is just the product of its side length. The measure of the empty set is zero, and the countable union of pairwise disjoint sets is the sum of the measure of the parts. All other properties we have observed follow from this. The only property we cannot easily generalize is what area rectangles should have, as in other spaces there might not be anything we can call a rectangle. Thus, without this property, we obtain the properties a general measure should have. With all these observations in mind, we are ready to define a measure space. A measure space consists of three objects. X can be any set. A is a sigma algebra on X, which is the collection of all the measurable sets, and mu is a measure with the properties we have just formulated. When we want to describe a set with a measure, most often we want as many measurable sets as possible. Given a measure space, we can extend the measure a bit with the following construction. When we have a set of measure 0, it is reasonable to say that every subset of that set should also have measure 0, regardless of whether this subset is measurable or not. The completion of a measure space extends the measure space by adding all sets to the sigma algebra, which are subsets of sets of measure 0. The extended measure assigns to all previously measurable sets still the same measure. With all of this in place, we are ready to construct the Lebesgue measure on the regular n-dimensional space. For one dimension, this measure is just usual length, for two dimension its area, and for three dimensions its volume. To construct this measure, we start with the sigma algebra generated by n-dimensional rectangles. This is called the Borel algebra on Rn. Then we define the Borel measure space by stating that the measure on the Borel algebra should assign to all n-dimensional rectangles the product of the length of the sides. It can be proven that this condition uniquely determines the measure on the entire space. In the third step, we complete the Borel measure space to obtain the Lebesgue measure space. Let's look at other examples of measure spaces which show that the measure does not have to represent size in the usual sense. The Dirac measure is focused on one single point x. The Dirac measure of any set which includes this point is 1. Every set which does not include x has measure 0. This function satisfies all of the conditions for a measure. Another measure is the counting measure. This measure just gives the number of points a set includes. When dealing with a measure space, we often do not want to look at the whole space, but just at what happens in a certain region. Here, the subspace measure helps. For any measurable subset, we may define a new measure space which just focuses on this subset and assigns the same measure to sets inside the subset as the measure on the whole space would. Now that we know how the domain of a function which we want to integrate has to look like, we should look at which functions from a measure space to the real numbers can be integrated. If we take a part of the range of the function and want to approximate the function in this region, we can look at where the function takes on the values in this part of the range. This is called the preimage. Then we fit a rectangle under the graph. The area of the rectangle is then the lower bound of the interval times the measure of the preimage of the interval. To justify this, we have to assume that the preimage is measurable. This leads us to the definition of a measurable function. Let's look at the simplest example of a measurable function, the characteristic function of a measurable set. The function takes on the value 1 if the x value is in the measurable set and otherwise takes on the value 0. The area under the curve of this function is just a rectangle whose area is the measure of the measurable set. Thus, we define the integral of a characteristic function as the measure of the measurable set it's describing. We can now look at the Dirichlet function and understand what its integral should be. The Dirichlet function was defined as being equal to 1 on the rationals and equal to 0 on the irrationals. Clearly, this is the same as the characteristic function of the rational numbers. So its integral over the interval from 0 to 1 is the Lebesgue measure of the rational numbers between 0 and 1. We may rewrite this as the disjoint union of single element sets. As the rational numbers are countable, we can turn the union into a summation. The Lebesgue measure of a single element is equal to 0, So we get that the Lebesgue integral of the Dirichlet function is equal to 0. Let's turn back to the study of measurable functions. The next simplest measurable functions are called simple functions. A simple function only takes on finitely many values and can be written as a linear combination of characteristic functions. We define the integral of a simple function to be the sum of the coefficients times the measure of the sets. We assume that all the sets have finite measure to avoid an infinity minus infinity situation. With a definition of the integral for simple functions, we are able to look at measurable non-negative functions. We can approximate these functions from below with simple functions. As the approximation becomes better, the area under the simple function approaches the area under the curve. As the simple functions approximate from below, a higher value of the integral of the simple function always yields a better approximation. Thus, we define the integral of a non-negative function to be the supremum, that is, the lowest upper bound, of the integral of all non-negative simple functions which are pointwise smaller than the function we are integrating. Finally, we can talk about the integral of arbitrary measurable functions. To reduce this to the case of a non-negative function, we split the function into the positive and the negative part. Both of these parts are non-negative, so we can integrate them. To avoid a situation where the positive and negative part have an infinite integral, and we thus obtain an infinity minus infinity situation, we require that the integral of the absolute value is finite. Functions which satisfy this condition are called Lebesgue integrable. Then we can define the integral of the function to be the integral of the positive part minus the integral of the negative part. Now that we have defined the Lebesgue integral for an arbitrary measure space, we may look at how the integral looks like for some specific measure spaces. For the Lebesgue measure, the Lebesgue integral over a bounded interval of a function, which is Riemann integrable, is just the same as the Riemann integral of that function. We don't have to assume the function is Lebesgue integrable, as every Riemann integrable function is also Lebesgue integrable. For the counting measure, the Lebesgue integral is the same as summing all of the values of the function. For the Dirac measure, the Lebesgue integral is the function evaluated at the point x, which the Dirac measure is centered around. One of the major advantages of the Lebesgue integral over the Riemann integral is the better behavior with limits. We often encounter situations where we want to interchange a limit and an integral. So we got a sequence of functions which converges pointwise, so for a fixed x the values of the functions converges, and we want to interchange the limit and the integral. Unfortunately, this is not generally possible, but there are some theorems which give conditions under which it is. The two most important theorems are the monotone convergence theorem, which assumes that the sequence of function is non-negative and non-decreasing, and the dominated convergence theorem, which assumes that the sequence of functions is dominated by an integrable function. If these two theorems don't apply, we can always use Fatous Lemma, which doesn't allow us to interchange limit and integral, but at least gives an upper bound for the value of the integral. Let's take a look at the monotone convergence theorem. This theorem assumes that the sequence of functions is non-negative and non-decreasing, so every function of the sequence is lower or equal than the next function pointwise. Then the interchange of limit and integral is allowed. For the dominated convergence theorem, we assume that all functions of the sequence are dominated by an integrable function, so the absolute value of all the functions in the sequence has to be lower or equal to the dominating function pointwise. Then the interchange of limit and integration is justified. In this example, the red function always dominates over the blue function. As the integrals of functions approaches zero, the integral of the limit function is also zero. If every function of the sequence is non-negative, Fatous Lemma gives an upper bound on the integral of the limit function. This upper bound is the limit as n tends to infinity of the greatest lower bound of all of the integrals. This is called the limit inferior and can be thought of as providing the greatest lower bound of the sequence of integrals when we look at how they develop as n tends to infinity. If the sequence of integrals converges, the limit inferior is the same as a regular limit. One of the most important applications of measure theory is in probability theory. A measure space can naturally be interpreted as a probability space when we interpret the whole space to be a sample space, which is the set of all possible outcomes. The sigma algebra of measurable sets is interpreted as an event space where the measurable sets are events to which we assign a probability, and the measure is interpreted as a function which assigns to each event a probability. Naturally, the probability of the sample space is equal to 1. Now we are able to describe the probabilities with measure theory. For example, we can take a look at the flipping of a coin. The sample space consists of the two possible outcomes, tail, and head. The event space consists of all possible events, like we get tails or we get heads. The probability measure can be defined by the number of elements in an event divided by 2. In this way, the probability of an event with just tails or just head is equal to 1/2. The probability of the heads or tails is 1, and the probability of neither is 0. A random variable can be interpreted as a measurable function from the sample space to the real numbers. On the coin flipping space, we can, for example, define a random variable by assigning 1 to tails and -1 to heads, which may describe a situation where you get $1 when you get tails and lose $1 if you get heads. The expected value of a random variable can also be described by measure theory. It is the integral of the random variable over the sample space with respect to the probability measure. For the coin flipping space, this is just the sum of the values of the random variable times the respective probability. For the random variable we just looked at, the expected value would thus be 0, just as we would expect. Let's now look at how we can describe a probability with a probability density function. When we have a random variable on the probability space, how can we measure the probability that the value of the random variable is within a certain measurable set E? We may call this probability P with subscript X, and it is evidently the probability of the preimage of E under X, which may be R written as the integral of 1. To describe this probability within the Lebesgue measure space, we introduce the probability density function. Then the probability Px of E is equal to the integral of the probability density function over the set E. For example, the normal distribution is such a probability density function.